This is Tim.
This is Kumar.
And this is Deconstructing Comics. Deconstructing Comics, sponsored by ComicsNow.com. Now that I finished ranting about USB headphones to Kumar and figuring out our schedule and so forth, today we're going to talk about the R. Crumb Handbook. Now, Kumar recommended we review this. I don't know, had you read it already before you mentioned it to me? Or
no, but this was another one that came out of that San Francisco series that you were thinking about doing, or that theme that you were trying to follow.
Oh, yeah. Originally, we were going to do this and Four Immigrants in the same show and ended up doing
it
that way.
So I guess as soon as the word San Francisco came up, I thought of R. Crumb. Even though he wasn't from San Francisco, he was such a central part of that scene, maybe the core of it even.
Mm-hmm.
The underground comic scene when it happened in the late 60s. So I immediately thought of that. The problem is there's no real best of Crumb volume. I mean, Fantagraphics has put out the complete Crumb,
mm-hmm.
which is a little bit too complete. If I mean, if you just want a kind of best of thing, you can't really pick up any of those because they have every little thing he drew in that period.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the early volumes even have some of his greeting card art that they could find in it. And they've also published like 7 volumes of his sketchbooks or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But there's no real single, and there's lots of big coffee table type hardcovers.
Mm-hmm.
But there's no real kind of convenient best of things that you could read by your bedside. But the R. Crumb Handbook did come out a few years ago, and I think it's probably out of print now, since every book I've chosen is out of print.
Hmm.
Almost. But anyway, it's kind of handbook-sized, and it is kind of a best of, but that's without jumping the gun, that's kind of one of the problems with the book. Anyway, but anyway, I thought it's as a kind of career overview of
mm-hmm.
Robert Crumb, it's the only thing I think that's available in a single volume.
Mm-hmm. And of course, this is put together by Crumb himself and Peter Poplaski.
Yeah.
It's a lot of his work and some commentary in together with it in Crumb's voice. I don't know if it's kind of. Poplaski is actually writing it. He interviewed.
It sounds like it was a prolonged interview or something,
mm-hmm.
and it's got all this. It's got basically R. Crumb's whole life history and philosophy, and
mm-hmm.
each point is illustrated by usually some cartoon that he himself has drawn at some point,
mm-hmm.
illustrating exactly the point that's being made at that stage in the writings.
Yeah. So the text and the artwork fit together well, you know, chronologically.
Yeah.
And sometimes a lot of the work he doesn't even bother to give it a caption because just the text that's on the facing page pretty much
explains
it.
What it is,
or the words in the comic itself. So the early part of the book, there's maybe more text. The text kind of dies out as it gets more into the heart of his career, and it becomes more comics. But I found the first part really interesting in the way that it sort of paints a picture of the era that he grew up in.
Right, right.
And
the repression of his Catholic upbringing.
Yeah, well, it doesn't sound like he had a very happy family life, which I guess isn't surprising to learn. But
no, and if you see the documentary, I think it's even more explicit in how messed up his family was,
mm-hmm.
or his family life, because they interview all of the members, and of course Charles, who was a tremendous influence on Crumb's life and who he writes about constantly.
Yeah, his older brother.
Right, killed himself shortly after the documentary was made. So there you go.
But he also talks about how much TV influenced him and and how he started to kind of notice that he was being kind of fed things by the TV.
Right, right. That's right, yeah.
And he seems to have picked that up at a pretty early age, too.
Yeah, yeah. That's kind of amazing. But I guess it's kind of a chicken and egg thing. I guess he was gifted enough to realize that at a young age that he was being fed junk culture. Because he absolutely hates it now. That's exactly the kind of thing he despises.
Yeah, well, he seems to have become cynical at a pretty early age, too, which I guess isn't surprising.
Yeah. Yeah. I actually read something somewhere else, in some interview with him recently, where he was talking about how he was raised Catholic, but then they just believed that was totally right. And then one of his Protestant friends took him to meet a minister, and then they talked to the minister, and the minister explained to them how Catholicism was all completely wrong, and he had this complete breakdown where it wasn't like, oh my God, I'm wrong, but oh my God, everybody's wrong. Like, they're all wrong. And that was really young for him, I think, when he was still in school.
So, now, I should mention here that I had really not seen much of Crumb's work before I read this. I wasn't very familiar with it.
Well, that's one of the reasons I chose it. But that's one of the because I thought it would be an overview of his career, but it's kind of problematic. It pretty clearly illustrates his philosophy in life, but or his philosophies, I should say. But it's a lot of the comics in it are fragments. They're only a couple of pages and not the full strips. And some of them, which were originally created for tabloid size pages, have been reduced to handbook size. So they're barely legible almost.
Yeah, well, I guess now that you mention it, what I kind of felt like was missing was, I mean, we see a lot of his work, but we don't get a very good idea of the context that it appeared in. Kind of the mechanics of his career, not his work, but when it was published and what form, that's kind of missing here.
Yeah,
and it doesn't even tell like exactly when each thing was published.
Right.
I mean, I'm thinking.
Yeah, it tells you where it came from.
This maybe was in the '60s. This maybe was in the '70s.
Right.
But you're kind of guessing.
Right. But sorry, I cut you off. You were going to express your shock or something of
the
sort.
Well, I was going to say, a couple years ago, before he went to Los Angeles, Mulally had loaned me a DVD of the Crumb documentary, and of course I never got around to watching it.
Okay.
That's typical of me.
Okay.
So because I never got around to watching it, this was sort of my first big exposure
to
Crumb.
Exposure. Okay. Okay.
Although I am old enough to remember when the Fritz the Cat movie came out.
Okay. But
I was only about 5 or 6 years old and was like, oh, it's a cartoon. My mom was like, no, we're not gonna go see that.
right. There were two of those, and he writes extensively in the book about how much he hated that movie and regretted ever having
Yeah, and I didn't realize that Ralph Bakshi was involved in that.
Yeah, yeah.
I mainly associate him with the Mighty Mouse cartoon in the '80s.
Right. I always think of I always think of Lord of the Rings with Ralph Bakshi and, weird projects that never made any money or something. Wasn't he involved in the Heavy Metal movie, too, maybe?
Yeah, I think you're right.
Yeah.
And now that you mention it, I've heard him involved, mentioned in connection with that. But
right. So anyway, this book is one of those books that they advertise as being, as being necessary or, great reading for old fans and newcomers alike. So the question is, was it a satisfying read for you as a newcomer to the work of R. Crumb?
Yeah, well, aside from the fact that it lacked some context, I thought we got a good sense of what kind of work he did,
right?
The kind of his way of thinking, his philosophy as it was coming out on the page.
Mm-hmm.
And it was interesting to me. Well, I mean, of course, I had a sense that his work was pretty ribald sometimes.
Right.
Although, now, what's interesting is that other times it isn't ribald at all.
Yes.
Like I liked the Crumb family pages where he and his wife did a comic together about themselves talking
right.
to each other. Those were pretty
right.
entertaining.
Well, it would take forever to explain it all, but it seems to me that he had several stages in his career.
Mm-hmm.
And in the 60s, he himself states that as soon as he became famous, he wanted to kind of shed that fame.
Mm-hmm.
So he deliberately did stuff that was as offensive as possible.
Yeah, and he didn't like his best-known work being Keep on Truckin' either.
Right, yeah, right. And he didn't like that. And so he just amped up the sex and the whatever kind of disgustingness he could get out of it.
Mm-hmm.
Even though it was coming from, it was coming from inside himself. I guess he just didn't depict it before, but he just made it more explicit and to deliberately push people away. And he said it worked. It pushed those people away, the people, you know, that were just on board because they were on the bandwagon of liking the work of R. Crumb.
Mm-hmm.
But actually, he really, his work, especially in the 80s, I think was his real peak, mid-80s, the work he did for Weirdo, which is some of the stuff that he did with his wife, Aline,
mm-hmm.
in that section was from that era. And his artwork became less cartoony and more refined and realistic. And even the execution of stories became really much more controlled, because a lot of the stuff in the 60s is very... it's very random. I mean, there's a connection from one panel to the next, but there's no through line almost through the whole story. And a lot of it's just kind of psychedelic, you know,
yeah.
whacked out stuff that is not supposed to have any kind of narrative logic anyway. And he doesn't really do that in the 80s. That was kind of something he left behind in the 60s.
Mm-hmm.
And another thing to add to that point about the explicitness of his work is that actually a lot of his cohorts of that same period were much, much more explicit in terms of sex and violence, especially S. Clay Wilson comes to mind.
He wasn't
the worst of the bunch.
It's kind of hard to imagine. But...
yeah, it's hard to imagine, but he wasn't the worst of the bunch, although he was the one that caused problems with the Joe Blow story, the incest story.
Mm.
Which is one of his most, I'd say one of the two or three most notorious R. Crumb stories. And it's reprinted in all the books, but it's the one that really got them into trouble and ended up almost crushing the underground comics movement, because a lot of the shops wouldn't carry the books anymore after that. I think there was some sort of court obscenity case regarding that story specifically.
Mm-hmm. Now, Poplaski in this book defends that story as being, I'm looking at the right page here. Joe Blow, a satire on family values and parental influence.
Definitely.
And yeah, I can see that. Although, I mean, I think the incest sort of shoves that aside. It makes it hard to kind of appreciate that, I think.
I think the incest is kind of like, it's kind of like in the story, the incest goes on, and it's almost like, well, we're a proper family, so anything we do is acceptable, by American moral standards. It doesn't really matter what we do. It doesn't really matter what we do at home, as long as we look good, you know, to the rest of the world, kind of thing. I thought it was, you know, all of R. Crumb's stuff is really kind of anti-establishment, anti-authority, anti-systems, basically. I never really had a problem with the story, or maybe I did the first time, but I find that all of the Crumb stories always read better the second time you read them. Because sometimes you're a bit shocked the first time. And the second time you read them and you know what's coming, they're often quite hilarious compared to the first time.
Once you kind of get past the shocking aspect of it.
Yeah, once you've been shocked once, it kind of it doesn't shock you the second time, and you read it and you realize kind of how hilarious it is. One of the other notorious ones is the one where Mr. Natural has sex with the giant baby in the desert, which was another one that he got into a lot of trouble for.
Yeah, which Poplaski says was a caricature of one of Crumb's girlfriends, the baby.
Right. Crumb must have, I guess, had some girlfriend that dressed up like a baby or something. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't get why he portrayed her as a baby. But
I don't know. Maybe she acted like she wanted to act like a baby or something. I don't know. Well, Crumb says that the book he has done, because of what his fame has afforded him, he has actually performed every act that he's depicted in his comics. So if you've seen some of the stuff which is not in this book, it's kind of like you can read it and say this is totally shocking, nobody would do this, but you know, he's done it apparently at some stage.
And then there's a CD in the front of this book,
right,
which is Crumb's sort of band, I guess.
Various bands over the years.
And so and he writes about it later in the book, and it just kind of comes out of nowhere. It's like all of a sudden the topic is music now. He really likes the kind of early 20th century records, the era of the 78s.
Yeah, ragtime and blues, yeah.
And so the music on the CD comes from various genres, and most of it is, there are a few songs that are kind of ribald. I guess it's just about a cat, isn't it? My Girl's Pussy.
I know that the song you're talking about is My Girl's Pussy, and I didn't listen to the lyrics that closely, but I don't think it's just about a cat.
But what surprised me was I had heard that song before.
Oh, right. And so it's a standard.
But I had only heard the instrumental section of it.
Okay.
And I thought about it. I heard it, and like, where have I heard this before? And as I thought about it, I concluded that it had to have been that they used just the instrumental section, like, leading up to the top of the hour on the Armed Forces Network. like 10 or 15 years ago. Not recently.
Wow, okay.
And so I was like, hearing this, and like, I heard this a long time ago. Where did I hear this? And that's the only place I can think of that it could have come from.
Wow.
But, of course, they didn't tell you what the title was, and they didn't get to the lyric section, so it seemed harmless. But
bizarre.
And of course, it's just about a cat anyway, so.
Right. I would say that the music that he likes is what we would consider very innocent and tame compared to the comics that he creates. Because his comics are very iconoclastic, kind of anti every other comic that's ever come before, except for Harvey Kurtzman's Mad Stuff, which of course was a huge influence on all the underground cartoonists. But it just seems like his comics are so advanced, and his music is so fixated on nostalgia.
Well, I know that back in those days, a lot of well, I don't know how prevalent it was, but a number of people put out these kind of double entendre records,
right.
You know, Davy's Dinghy and that kind of thing, where you know it's ostensibly about something else, but you know it can be read as something sexual.
Right. Wasn't there a Chuck Berry song called "I Want You to Ring My Ding-a-Ling" or something?
Yeah,
like
Dr. Demento played that a lot.
Right. Right. Yeah, but anyway, at least the songs on the sampler are not, except for "My Girl's Pussy," which you know may have a double meaning.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, it might. I don't know.
Yeah. They're all really kind of innocent, which I don't know. It struck me as a strange dichotomy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm not sure. It's an interesting aspect of his personality, I guess. But
Anyway, I think the CD is really good, and it's worth the ticket price alone, because the book is about, you know, it's $20 or $25, and you get this 1 hour long CD
mm-hmm.
along with this hardcover book that's 400 pages. I mean, that's a pretty good deal, if you ask me.
Yeah. Now, yeah. So one other thing that kind of stuck out for me, late in the book, page 386, there's this two-page thing that Crumb writes, it's so negative about life and everything. I mean, it reads almost like a suicide note.
Right.
It's so down.
Right.
And
right.
like the way that humans procreate is hateful and everything is hateful and it's just so depressing to read.
Right.
Where did this come from? It's like, yeah, the litany of hate.
Yeah.
I mean, I found that, you know, I almost want to say that was the most offensive thing in the whole book.
But you know, he hasn't killed himself, and
surprisingly,
he seems to get as rough as his relationship with his son Jesse might be. I think his relationship with his daughter Sophie is good. I would imagine that he gets pleasure in his life from from his daughter and his wife, who he seems to have been happily married to for, you know, 20 or 30 years now.
And we also get in the inside back cover this depression graph where he goes through his life and shows how depressed he was at each stage.
Right. But that's hilarious. That's funny. Because if you look at the cartoons are funny. Those are funny cartoons. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, a depression art, it's R. Crumb's depression graph. I mean, there's no way you can really take that seriously. It's I mean, I don't want to say he can't take it seriously, but it's deliberately funny. He's deliberately making fun of his own.
Yeah.
He knows how depressed he gets. He knows he gets depressed for stupid things. And he knows he looks around, he sees other people, they're happy. He hates them for being happy. And he knows it's stupid to hate them for being happy. And he makes a comic about it. And it's hilarious, you know?
Yeah. And then there's like brief thoughts of suicide, exclamation point.
Yeah.
And then at the end, this arrow pointing off towards death with another exclamation point. And
with a skull.
Skull there, yeah. And this guy with like big keep on trucking feet walking off to the towards death.
Right. I understand there's a problem with the litany of hate, because the litany of hate is just hate, and it's just prose, it's just text.
Mm-hmm.
But R. Crumb's depression graph is a comic strip. You know, it's a deliberately humorous comic strip about how ridiculous his levels of depression are, and that he would put them on a graph with these silly little cartoon drawings on them.
And we get a couple of things in here where he's like making fun of the art world. Those are kind of interesting. I enjoyed the Moto Day and her pals strip where they get this kind of weird big knickknack thing. I'm not even sure what it was supposed to be.
Right, they find it in the dump, right?
Yeah, and everybody thinks it's kind of worthless, and then she and the dog think it's kind of worthless, and then these other people come in and say, oh, it's such great art, and and she's going to sell it for a lot of money. And
yeah. That strip, I think, was from his weirdo period, mid-80s.
Mm.
Which my feeling is was his absolute peak for me. So yeah, I think that was, he was at his height of his satirical powers, I think.
Yeah. So anything else you'd like to say about it?
Well, there's we still haven't. Well, I'd like to say that as an old reader, this it's a bit. I mean, I had a problem with the reproduction size, as I said before, that some of these things, which would have been newspaper size, are reduced to handbook size. And I didn't like that some of the strips were cut, you know, down to one page or whatever to illustrate the point. And I had issues with, obviously, if you've been reading for a long time, supposedly if this is good for old fans and newcomers alike, I mean, if you're an old fan, you've got favorite strips. And it really bothered me that he went on, there was a long section talking about the stage production of White Man Meets Bigfoot. But the strip, White Man Meets Bigfoot, is not reproduced in the book.
Yeah,
it's about a 16-page strip, and it's absolutely peak. It's an excellent, excellent story. I think he did it in around 71 or something like that. But it's so – it's one of his most brilliant pieces, and it's – I can't understand why they wouldn't have reprinted that in here.
Yeah, I guess now that you mention it, yeah, he talks a lot about it, but then – and we get maybe
you
a
only
few
get
panels
one or two panels.
Mm-hmm.
Or,
yeah,
you know,
194,
like details of panels. You don't even get whole panels of it, I don't think.
But, yeah, we don't ever see the whole story in here.
Yeah, that was – so I think it was kind of and there's not enough weirdo stuff in it, not enough of the 80s stuff. It seems to be reprinted a lot of the 60s stuff, which I guess was easier because, I mean, the 60s stuff often was just like one-pager type things.
Well, could there have been some kind of copyright issue? Or
no, none at all.
No.
I guess they just felt some of that stuff had been reprinted too much in other places.
That
something.
May be. But then how are you going to, like, digest all the best stuff if you're going to say, well, this has already appeared in too many other places?
Yeah, exactly. And they talk, or at the beginning in the intro, they talk how they had done another book together and they didn't want to repeat themselves or something. And I'm not sure what that other book was, but, anyway, like I said, for me, this book kind of missed the point in – missed the mark of being a best of again, because again, like there's all those giant 20-pound hardcover coffee table books of R. Crumb collected stuff based on theme like family or whatever, or R. Crumb's women. But there's no that I can think of any real single best of volume that's, you know, like 300 pages of stuff that anybody could read. Yeah, so I kind of had that issue with it.
Okay.
And I will add also, totally, almost completely off subject, that a lot of Crumb's raw stuff from the late 60s, a lot of which is reprinted earlier in this book, is part of a lot of it's very stream of consciousness. As I mentioned before, there's no narrative thread. Running through it, and it's one of the reasons I've recently begun to feel that comic writers the term is meaningless. Because in my mind, you can put any two random images together and create a comic strip. Because if you follow that McCloudian theory that the meaning is created between the panels, then it doesn't matter what the two panels are. Even if you go to an art gallery and see two paintings by the same artist next to each other, your brain creates associations between them, whatever they may be. And it might be the most minor association, like he did this one after this one, or this one's better than this one. There's some sort of association there. And my feeling is that even in comics, if you put two completely random panels together, your brain will make some sort of association. And it doesn't matter whether that association has any meaning or has any value or anything. It exists. So my point is that the comic exists without having been written, without having anyone to write it. It will exist anyway if you put two panels together.
Interesting.
And for me, it was all that, and not just Crumb, but a lot of the underground artists who were basically out of their mind on drugs, particularly acid, would just draw these totally random comics. But I mean, they're just drawing one panel after the other, and it just ends, you know, oh, I'm just going to write the end on this panel, and that's the end of it. And it's just got nothing to do with anything. It's just a bunch of, you know, random drawings of whatever for two pages, and then that's the end. And you might not get any kind of narrative pleasure out of it, but I guess if you were on acid as a reader yourself, you might, you know, enjoy it or something.
Yeah, so the comic's equivalent of 2001 A Space Odyssey.
Right. So My feeling is that was after reading a lot of the Underground stuff, particularly Crumb's early stuff, which is, you know, has dialogue, you know, sometimes, but it's just one guy. It's just somebody goes into a shop and buys a hamburger, and then it's like, yay, hamburgers, and that's the end of the strip. And there's a pleasure from those strips. They're kind of funny in their bizarreness, even if you're not on drugs.
Mm-hmm.
And those comics are kind of amazing and not like any other comics you've seen before. But there's no writing per se involved.
Mm-hmm. Hmm. Interesting.
Yeah.
Now, we haven't mentioned yet that aside from the sexual aspects that some people might find offensive, he also plays with the kind of like racial stereotypes, especially the Angel Food McSpade,
right. Okay, yep.
Who's
yep.
a black character who,
right.
You know, is
kind
the
of a like, tribal mm-hmm. spear thrower type, yeah.
Yeah, and drawn in the kind of like early 20th century caricature yep. of black people with the huge white yep. lips and that. And
yeah.
what was he trying to express by having a character like that?
Well, I think he was always, my feeling is he was always depicting the way the mass culture viewed those people,
mm.
or viewed blacks as being kind of, you know, less cultured, or, you know, being spear throwers or whatever.
Mm.
Because if you've seen, if you take a look at R. Crumb's portraits of blues musicians,
mm-hmm.
I think there might even be one of those coffee table books that you can't afford £100, which is R. Crumb's portraits of black blues musicians. He has more love for those musicians than anybody else does. And that love really comes out in those portraits.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see how you could, if you looked at Angel Food McSpade and said, oh, you know, R. Crumb is racist, it's just such an obvious racist caricature that it's hard. It's not like he came up with it himself and said, oh, black people have lips like this and wear grass skirts.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you looked at his blues book, there's no way you can resolve the two. And there's no way you could look at the blues book and say this man hates black people or something, or belittles black people,
mm-hmm.
you know? Because if anything, he elevates them to, he feels that they deserve to be, you know, have a higher status in our culture than anybody else.
Mm. Yeah, like if you look at some of these album covers, which I guess he drew, these look like his
yeah.
art. Yeah.
Yeah.
And a lot of them are black musicians who he right. is portraying on the covers in a very realistic way.
Yeah. 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 That's what his portraits are like. Unfortunately, in this book, there's very little. There's not much of that except for those very small reproductions of the album covers.
Mm-hmm.
So again, anyone reading this book would only have Angel Food McSpade to go on, and you know, would only have the Joe Blow story to go on, and really wouldn't have. There's small rebuttals from Poplawski and other people saying, "Oh, Robert Crumb is this. He's not actually racist, and he doesn't believe in incest," or whatever statement like that, but the book itself kind of, it lacks its own rebuttal in the artwork it presents.
Mm.
So it's a little bit incomplete in that sense as mm-hmm. well.
Yeah. So you said you've seen some of the other collections that were also lacking in some way. Do you think they're not lacking.
They're just too. They're like $60. And
nah.
they weigh like 15 pounds. They're these giant hardcovers
mm-hmm.
That don't fit on your bookshelf. They're, yeah. they're for your coffee table or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But they're kind of, they tend to be themed like R. Crumb's family or R. Crumb's women. Or there's a new one that came out called The Softer Side of R. Crumb. You know, well, that's fine and all, but this thing is, it's massive and it's too expensive and it's not. It only shows one side often. Of his career.
So okay, so if what would be the perfect R. Crumb book for you, in terms of the format, the size, and also the content?
The format would be like kind of magazine sized.
Okay.
Or standard comic size, one of the two.
Hmm.
It would be like, it would be all comics. It would be like maybe 300 pages, something like that. Of just comics, and full career spanning 60s through 80s, lots of weirdo stuff included. I think. That, I think, would be ideal. But at the same time, that there's something lacking in that, too, because part of R. Crumb's career, which is, I don't want to say unseen, but his sketchbooks, because he sketches habitually. And when I say sketch, I mean he doesn't really sketch. He draws full comics in his sketchbooks, which aren't meant for publication. They're just kind of his, I don't want to say thoughts. It's not like a diary. It could be a comic about, you know, whatever. It could be it could be a piece of fiction, but in a sense, it encapsulates his state of mind at the moment that he's drawing it. And since it's not intended for publication, there's almost less of there's less interference between the artist and the reader. It's a little bit more direct. And those sketchbooks are really, they've been printed now, but I mean, they weren't ever really intended to be put into comic books. But they're really, really kind of, they're really incredible a lot of the time. And there's no way that would fit into the format of a best of comics of R. Crumb. You'd have to have a best of sketchbook volume 2 kind of thing, I think.
Well, I imagine he's worked on various page sizes, so that presents a problem.
That's true, too, yeah. That is a problem with having any sort of best of, yeah. Because the early stuff was, like, newspaper-sized, and then in the 60s he was working in standard comic size, and then in the 80s in Weirdo it was kind of magazine-sized, so...
Yeah, and like you mentioned, some of the comics pages are really shrunk, like page 150, the Mr. Natural strip. It's five rows of comics stuck on one page.
Hang on a second. I know exactly the one you're
talking
about.
The lettering looks quite small at this size.
Yeah, that I'm sure would have been in the East Village Other or one of those big tabloid size things.
Mm-hmm.
And they've reduced it to, you know, 5x7 or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, I don't know. I guess this book is a decent primer, but it's not the perfect, quote unquote, perfect for old fans and newcomers alike.
Mm-hmm.
It's definitely, I don't know what a person who'd never read R. Crumb would think after reading this.
Well, I guess that's pretty much me. So, I mean,
let me put it away. A person who's never read comics.
A person who's never read comics.
Or who's never heard of R. Crumb, let's say.
Okay. So if I had no idea what to expect when I picked this up.
Right.
Whereas, you know, I had a fairly good idea. But
sure, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I guess, you know.
Well, the thing is, it's on the cover. I mean, on the front cover, he says, you know, his character saying, "I'm not here to be polite."
Mm-hmm.
And on the back cover, it says, you know, "Remember, it's just lines on paper. It's only lines on paper, folks."
Mm-hmm.
So, he kind of, you know, there's, once you take those two statements together, there's no way you can criticize anything in the book, no matter how offensive it is. It's only lines on paper, and he's not here to please people.
Yeah.
So, you know, what are you going to say? Like, this didn't please me. Well, that's what it said on the cover, you know? this incest scene is happening. It's only lines on paper, you know?
Yeah. And, of course, how you take it depends on what your, you know, what belief system, whatever you bring to it, too. I mean...
That's true, too, yeah.
Two different people who've never heard of R. Crumb, one might find it hilarious and one might be really offended.
Sure. Well, I mean, and also the offended person, I often wonder why they would be reading the R. Crumb comics in the first place. because, I mean, the kind of person, let's say, who would be offended by an R. Crumb comic would not be the kind of person to go out, seek one out, and read one anyway.
Well, no, but I mean, I can imagine situations where they might happen across one accidentally,
yes,
you know, on somebody else's bookshelf or something.
For sure.
Yeah,
for sure. Yeah. Yeah.
I'm like, oh, gee, what's this? Oh, my God. Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Actually, I read on Amazon when I was looking at it, somebody was a librarian, and she pulled it from the shelves
because
she found it so offensive. She was so offended by the acts depicted in it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so there you go. I guess if you're a librarian or somebody who was out looking to ban books or something, you would... You probably end up reading it somehow.
Yeah. Okay. Anything else? We've been going almost 40 minutes now, so.
All right.
but if there's anything else crucial to mention, we should mention it.
I don't think so, but I don't think you can really encapsulate the man's career in 40 pages or 400 pages or 40 minutes. But a lot of, and his super realistic, beautiful stuff, a lot of it's not in this book, too. So
maybe they need to put out a series based on the different formats and page sizes, like do a big book that's big pages.
They could, but could they price it at $25 and not put a hardcover on it, is my question. Because that's the thing they always seem to do. Anyway, so basically, until that fantasy, that Aristotelian, you know, perfect book comes out, you're just gonna have to, you know, scrounge around and get whatever. The way they were printed.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess that defeats my own comment about wanting a 300-page collection, but. Mm-hmm. If you can find them, they're often they're still in print. Like, you know, Zap number 1 is up to printing number 37 or whatever. you can pick it up for $2 or $3 somewhere if you find it. So that might be the way to go anyway.
Yeah, it may just not be possible to do a single book about his career.
Yeah.
Deconstructing Comics is sponsored by ComicsNow.com, offering a discount of 30% off everything in stock. Subscribe to any number of comics series through Comics Now, and your discount is 35%. Comics Now provides many of the comics we review on this show. They also provide comics previews in Eric's newsletter, which you can read on our site, globalcomics.net. Our theme song is performed by Firewater. Are you getting started as a comics creator and looking for some feedback? Send us your comic at podcast@globalcomics.net and we'll critique it on the show. Also, if you'd like to send us a donation to help keep the show going, use the PayPal link on the podcast page at globalcomics.net. And it would be just as valuable to us if you'd post a glowing review of Deconstructing Comics in iTunes. Currently, all that's there is a couple of negative-leaning reviews of episodes from 2 years ago. This show has changed a lot since then, and we'd appreciate your help in making that clear to iTunes users. Savannah College of Art and Design recently published an anthology book called Discovered. Next week, Brandon and I attempt to review the book, and we fail. How to do a podcast review about an anthology? Do an interview instead. I call up Sean Crystal, a faculty member of the college, to talk about the project. Till then, thanks for listening. This is Tim. See you next week on Deconstructing Comics.
It's my girl's pussy.
See, I told you it was about a cat.